Need to talk about old people. Talk about Nancy and me. You do understand, of course, that you study a lot of things that may not apply to you right now, but it very well could in a few years. It will inevitably happen. And I think that is far superior to the alternative, and that is that you die young. That an option to old age is dying young. When we talk about family in later life, we're going to be talking about the time in life when families have moved beyond the child-rearing years. We have identified three stages. In fact, we're going to be dealing with three stages. We're going to be talking about the launching stage, the post-launching stage, and retirement. Launching, post-launching, and retirement. Now, what marks the beginning of the launching stage? What marks the beginning of the launching stage?
When they have adult children.
More specifically, when the first child leaves home. That begins the launching stage. And of course, the launching stage is completed when the last child leaves home. And that, of course, is when you're faced with a post-launching stage. All right. So that's really going to be the essence of our lesson tonight. Is talk about those three stages: the launching stage, the post-launching stage, and retirement stage. The launching stage begins when the first child leaves home and is completed when the last child leaves home. And of course, the task to be accomplished here is that our children achieve autonomy. Meaning that they should be able to care for themselves, they should be able to manage their finances, and be a responsible citizen. And if you as a parent have accomplished that, if you have reared your children that have come to the place that they're able to accomplish all of those feats, then you have done a very good job. A second mark, or the second task that needs to be accomplished, is that your adult children need to develop meaningful relationships and supportive systems. Let's refer back to Eric Erickson. Stage number five, young adulthood. What was a conflict that needed to be resolved in young adulthood? What are the positive resolution leads to what?
Identity and intimacy.
Identity is stage four, adolescence. Stage five is intimacy. The positive resolution is intimacy, and then, of course, if there's a negative resolution, what would that be? It's either intimacy or what?
Despair.
No, you're not quite despair yet. Despair is later on.
Yeah, that's,
that's the last stage. That's integrity or despair. You look back on your life as an old person, you either look back with integrity and feel like you've accomplished all that you had intended to accomplish, or you look back in despair and you moan over the fact that you haven't accomplished what you need to accomplish. Time's run out. But in young adulthood, it's intimacy versus, if you don't find intimacy, you're going to be
lonely
or isolated. All right, so the conflict is between intimacy and isolation. Okay? Now, let me address something here that I found to be very interesting, and I think that you would concur with this. Again, hopefully that adolescence is not so far removed from any of us that we can't at least remember a little bit about it. It's further removed from some than others. But we said that the primary task to be resolved during adolescence is what?
Identity.
However, there seems to be somewhat of a reversal between identity and intimacy for men and women. Now let me show you what I'm talking about. Guys, generally speaking, find their identity in being associated with a group, with a meaningful group, with their peer group. Girls, on the other hand, during adolescence, usually find intimacy with a smaller group of girls. Guys have more of a tendency to identify with a larger group, which gives them a sense of identity, and girls discover intimacy to a greater degree than guys do, because that's found in a smaller group of maybe two, three, or four real close friends. Now, in adulthood, young adulthood, we think in terms of finding intimacy, and that really is the overriding goal of every young adult. However, women have already gotten a head start on intimacy, and they find it more difficult to find identity as a young adult than men do, because they've pretty much already established their identity. On the other hand, guys have a harder time finding intimacy. And I think you would probably concur with that young men, say in their 20s, have a much more difficult time in expressing intimacy and experiencing intimacy than women do, right? Mm-hmm. Women experience intimacy much quicker and a higher degree, because they've already pretty much have prepared themselves through adolescence. And then, of course, guys, they got their identity intact, but they're short on intimacy. And women have a difficult time in finding their identity, of really knowing who they are. And of course, they begin to find their identity more so when they see themselves as a mother. Women find their purpose, at least for a season, in motherhood. But how well launching goes, and of course we're talking about launching our children into adulthood, into responsible adulthood, how well the launching goes will in large measure be determined at how well parents and adolescents have addressed and resolved their tensions that we have talked about earlier. We're talking about the tension between adolescence and midlife, right? And the more the more that these tensions have been resolved, will be smoother the transition into the launching stage. Parents can either hold on to the kids and remain attached to them too long, still trying to keep control, or they can sometimes push the kids out too early, prematurely. And what happens oftentimes is when the kids are pushed out prematurely, they're left floundering without support, and it's not surprising that they come crashing back, often impacting everyone in their path. Thus are sad and incomplete leavings just they're sad and incomplete leavings just as they're happy and satisfying leavings. Nancy doesn't like for me to address this, and I don't really like to think about it, but in one sense of the word, Nancy and I feel like that we may have pushed our younger kids out of the nest a little bit too early. And basically what happened is that I had resigned our pastorate over in Cartersville. Had decided to go back to University of Memphis in Memphis to finish my degree. And our two youngest boys, we thought, were old enough to be on their own. And I guess by many standards, they were. And yet, we think now that possibly that they would have made the transition much easier had it been under different circumstances and had been a little bit more drawn out instead of being abruptly. They were 19 and 21, and which, again, you would think, they were old enough. But that depends, again, on what kind of preparation has been made. It depends on their stage of development, their sense of being ready, their sense of being independent. You know, see, kids really are torn between two. They're torn between wanting to be on their own and the fear of being on their own. On one hand, they want to be independent, but on the other hand, they still want to hold on. They want the support to be there. And so, you know, that is something, I guess, that we just have to simply release and entrust to the Lord now, and to say, you know, hey, if there was a mistaken judgment, you know, God's going to have to forgive us for that, and he's going to have to make up for whatever lack there may have been. Because, you know, that both of these boys had a pretty rough sailing for a period of time, and one is in the process of kind of smoothing out now. But I can't take all the responsibility for that. I realize that. But there are a lot of factors involved in a smooth transition of our children from adolescence to young adulthood in the launching pad. So differentiation is a process whereby individuals assume their unique identity as separate from and yet connected to their family. Paulina McCullough and Sandra Rutenberg identified four tasks. And I want you to take note of this. You might want to jot these down. Four tasks, when accomplished, contribute to a successful transition. Four tasks that should be accomplished in order to have a smooth transition through the launching stage. First, the parents must refocus on their marriage relationship. Of course, we do understand that when kids are at home, a lot of your attention is on them. A lot of your energy goes toward their maintenance. When the kids leave home and you find yourself in the post-launching stage, mom and daddy find themselves all alone with an empty nest. And you find that there's a necessity to refocus on one another. And of course, if the marriage is doing well, the kids leaving home is going to unite the parents. If the marriage is not doing well, chances are it might be the final blow that will cause you to go your separate ways. A second task is related to the first, and this is when parents and children need to learn to relate to each other as adults. Parents and children must learn how to relate to one another as adults. And I think this was one of the things that I really just woke up to the fact one day, hey, my boys are no longer boys, they're men. They're adults. They're on their own. I can't condescend to them, or I can't force myself on them, or I have to be very careful about even giving my opinion. I find that the only time you should give your opinion when it's asked for, and then you probably ought to be reluctant. But you have to respect them. You have to respect their adulthood. You have to respect the fact that they, too, are an adult and they're more your peer. Now, I believe that that there will always be a proper respect between father and son. I cannot condescend to them. I cannot force myself on them. Again, I have to be very careful about trying to influence them into my way of thinking. But I told somebody one time, I said, I have a hard time when my youngest son calls me buddy. And I haven't had enough nerve to say anything to him because I'm not real sure that he's in his right mind, you know, all the time, that he might be under the influence of something else. And I said, look, I to be his friend, that's fine. I'm not sure I'm his buddy, you know. I still think there ought to be a differentiation there. I think that there will always be, or should be, a differentiation between father and son. That I think they expect you to continue to be their father. But to be a friend, to be a confidant, to be able to communicate, to be able to engage in activities on the same plane is certainly something that should be recognized and to be respected. A third task for successful launching is for parents to develop good relationships with their adult child's mate. For parents to establish a good relationship with the adult child's mate. I don't know whether that you would agree with this or not. Again, supposedly borne out by research, often the daughter-in-law, mother-in-law relationship is the most conflicted. The daughter-in-law and the mother-in-law relationship, and there are several reasons for that. And most of the time, it is because of the mother-in-law's insistence to continue to have a hand in matters, you know, to still want to influence or to make, quote, suggestions or insinuations to at least subtly to be in control.
I know in our family, the number one thing is you don't know them like I do. And if you'll just do this, this, and this, then they won't do this or this.
Now we're talking about the mother.
The mother will tell the daughter-in-law, I know the boys better than you do.
Oh, okay.
You just do this, this, and this. Oh. And they won't do this.
Oh, okay, I see.
And they're sitting there going, but I know them. I'm married. You know.
And they're the ones that have to live with them.
Yeah.
They're the ones that have to put up with them.
So there's a...
Of course, I had an aunt who really thought that men could do no wrong. I mean, really. She loved my wife. My wife loved her. And, I mean, they had a lot of mutual respect for one another. But I would assume... I don't know. I may have to take that back. If there was a conflict between Nancy and me, I don't know but what she wouldn't take up Nancy's side. But that would probably be the exception, because most of the time she thought, you know, the guy was in the right. You know, that went back to her husband, or if it went to her nephews, or whoever. I guess it's what Mom is saying. You know, hey, I know these boys, and if you want to live with them, you want to get along with them, you do this, because I know them better than you do.
See, I didn't have that with either one of my marriages. I got along right with my mother-in-law. We were best friends.
Would that be the exception or the rule? I don't know. And again, that all depends. It all depends on the in-laws. It all depends on the kids, and all depends on the mother-in-law, and it all depends on whether you have kids. It depends on how attached the son still is to the apron strings of the mother. And many times the conflict comes when the son compares the wife to the mother. Well, my mother did it this way. Or my mother, you know, fixed things. Hey, I learned a long time ago, I better back off. You know, I better be very, very careful. And even though my wife would agree that my mother was a very good cook, I was very hesitant to even ever mention how good a cook my mother was.
Yeah. I have one brother that is still so attached to the parents that one pretty much whatever they say, he listens to, and he will correct his wife and children on their say-so, but make it sound like it's coming from him after he goes back home.
Has the wife wised up yet?
Well, kind of, because then they go to their parents, and their parents will do the same thing. So when they come back home, they correct from what their parents are saying. And it's like total chaos 24/7.
And so,
no stability on their part the parents' part.
That goes back to the relationship of the child and the parent to start with.
Okay, namely?
Well, like if the
specifically?
If the parent is authoritative or authoritarian, permissive, or neglectful, the child's going to relate, and when they're going through adolescence, the how the child is allowed to break away to find
okay.
their own identity.
All right.
I know with me, I had two different kinds of parents. I had authoritative and I had authoritarian.
Meaning one, your father was one, your mother was...
My father was authoritative and my mother is authoritarian. And so still is. And she ruled the roost, what she said went.
Uh-huh.
And very hard to break away, you know, very very structured. So okay. Was not allowed to, when I look back, to be able to find who I was as a child. I had to wait till I broke completely away. And I think by that, because there was not a bonding there, that when I got married, it was easier to be accepted into that family as just a member. There was more of a mother-daughter relationship with
okay.
the in-laws. Where on the other hand, if the child is probably allowed to break away,
properly,
processes, you know, an identity-wise, knowing who they are.
Properly differentiated, yeah.
Then I could probably see where some of these little conflicts of, you know, I know them better than you do, that type of thing.
So it all depends on your relationship with your family of origin.
Mm-hmm. To start with. Mm-hmm.
And really what it boils down to is how enmeshed you are. That when you're so enmeshed with your family of origin, there has not been a proper breaking away or separatedness or differentiation there, right? Then probably the only way you were able to make the break was to appear in the eyes of your mother that you were rebellious.
Well, see, okay? In my family, I realized at a young age that I didn't know who I was. As a young, even past adolescence, I didn't know who I was even in adolescence. So in my mid-20s, that's when I began to realize I didn't know who my own identity was, even though I had already separated from my family, because they still had a lot of influence over me. So I purposed in my heart that I would not really seek to find a mate until I learned my own identity. So okay. It would be easier for me to walk into that relationship without the influence of my own family or their family. So I'd do it myself.
So that's what, when we find our identity, we're talking about the differentiated self, right?
And so now that I've found my identity, my family can't handle me.
Yeah. And see, you don't have to find yourself, and you don't have to become differentiated at the expense of being totally cut off. See, the healthy relationship is that the parent can let the child go, to respect the child, to trust the child. See, most times the parent will hold on, still wanting to have control, because they don't trust the child to make decision on his or her own. It's really a lack of respect. And so the parent has to come to the place of just simply saying, I let go, and I have to take the risk to believe that if they make a mistake, they will pick themselves up, they will find themselves, because that's the only way that they can really learn. That's the only way they can become independent. That's the only way that they can become autonomous. And then, of course, it doesn't necessitate you just breaking away completely. There should still be a healthy relationship, a healthy bond between you and your family of origin. There is, of course, there's also a possible conflict between the son-in-law and the mother-in-law. And this is usually the popular stereotype of a mother-in-law that's always interfering, which becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. The conflict, now listen to this is interesting. The conflict between the son-in-law and the father-in-law usually centers in the father-in-law's concern that the son-in-law is not providing adequately for his daughter. If the father of the daughter perceives that the husband is not providing for his daughter, then that would represent a conflict between the father-in-law and the son-in-law. It usually has to do with provision. Supposedly, the least conflictive relationship seems to be between the daughter-in-law and father-in-law. Again, you know, that's not always the case, but apparently is so more so than any of the other relationships. All right, a fourth task for successful launching is to resolve issues pertaining to the older generation. When parents have consumed their life and their energy on raising kids and getting them to the place that they get out on their own, and they get to the place they think, well, I've got freedom, I have some time for myself. There's always a consideration of the older generation, of aging parents. So that has to be resolved. And of course, the fewer resources that are available, specifically financial resources, higher the possibility of resentment of having to provide for aging parents. We're going to take a little bit closer look at aging parents and how that adult children play into the formula. And it basically comes back around to what we referred to as the initial relationship between a father and an infant child is one of a unilateral covenant. In other words, the child, the baby, cannot reciprocate, right? It's just one-sided. It's what the parent does, not expecting anything in return from the child. But as the relationship matures, as the relationship grows and the covenant becomes what we call a mature covenant, it becomes bilateral, meaning that it becomes more reciprocal. It has gone full cycle when aging parents have to then depend on their adult children. That is the full cycle, and we'll talk more about that in just a moment. A term here, boomerang children. Let's identify boomerang children. Boomerang children is the pattern of adult children leaving home only to return a few months or years later. Boomerang children means that they leave, but they come back. The noted country scholar and humorist Jerry Clowers said, "When your kids leave home, don't cry. Don't be so sad, because they'll be coming back and they'll be bringing more with them." They'll be coming back, they'll be bringing more with them. I used to tease my nephew who was in between our two younger sons, and he lost his mother, who was my sister, when he was 8 years old, and he would spend every summer with us until after he got out of high school. And we used to tease him. We said, you know, after you get married and get your kids, you'll still be coming back and spending the summer with us. I think I later discovered that I'm not real sure I'd be real happy with that arrangement. He very quickly got three kids, and I've come to the conclusion that no house is really big enough for two families, and especially when you get old and cranky and set in your ways, that it's for some reason it doesn't seem to pan out the way it ought. But family is important, right? There's always the need of knowing that there's somebody that's going to be there for you, somebody that's going to be supportive of you in your time of need. Let's look at the post-launching stage. Post-launching. Truly letting a child go is hard, not only because of the pain of separation, but because a child fully released will reclaim and reshape the relationship in a way that may not be entirely to the parent's liking. It's painful in seeing your children leave. Separation is painful. But probably more painful than that is the realization that your son or your daughter is going to become his or her own man or woman. And they are going to reshape the relationship in a way that we may not be quite ready to receive. Again, the difficult task is letting go. The task of parenting in adolescence is knowing when to let go and when to hold on. But then finally, you have to let go. You have to release the kids. And you have to come to realization that you may not be able to call the shots, even though that you may still be mama. Let's take a look at grandparenting. If some of you are not grandparents, and if even you never become grandparents, maybe you'd be put in a situation where you'll be able to minister to somebody that's in a situation that they need your counsel and they need your advice. And you can say, well, you know, I remember when Dr. Metters talked about that in marriage and family class, and hopefully in your time of need that you can recall from that great reservoir of knowledge that you have, and you can give them great words of wisdom. Grandparents are very, very important. Unfortunately, I feel cheated. And I mean this. I really feel very cheated. First of all, I've never really understood the love of any grandparent. I only had the privilege of seeing one grandparent. He was a loving grandfather in his own way, but I really never had any meaningful contact with him. Never had any real input from him. Fortunately, I had him until a couple of months before Nancy and I got married. I was 20 years old. We grew up in the same town, but yet never did have any real, you know, close. He was kind of the old school that maybe they didn't, I don't know. Maybe he's just different. Maybe he was just unique. But again, he was a good man. I have fond memories of him. But as far as really feeling like that I had any impartation of any great wisdom or really had any meaningful times with him, I feel cheated in that regard. But my maternal grandmother died when my mother was 12 years old. My paternal grandmother died when my daddy was 6 months old. My paternal grandfather died before I was born. And I really feel cheated, I really do. And then I suppose that I hope not too many people listen to this video or at least get offended, but in a way I feel like I've been cheated as a grandparent. And in some ways I know that maybe we could do some things differently because all of our grandchildren belong to our one son who's divorced from their mother, and you know, we have very limited contact there. However, we do have more access now than we've ever had in a way, but still, yes, very limited. And I can certainly see how important it could have been to me to have had grandparents in my life. And maybe when I get through tonight, I will have preached myself under conviction. And perhaps I will put myself in a position of being a better grandfather. And I still have the hope that we have two other sons that maybe will help us to get some more grandchildren. I don't know. I'm not real sure that I'm ready for that, or maybe they're not ready. And when they get ready, I would be very happy and very pleased with it. But grandparents serve a very important role in the life of grandchildren. They can provide the love, the support. They can provide understanding, listening. When maybe they have conflicts with their parents, not that you would interfere, but you're that non-judgmental adult figure that can represent some stability for their lives. And probably the greatest role of grandparents, I would think, would be in the impartation of values, spiritual values. I've always admired the black community because of the high regard, first of all, the very, very important role that mothers have played in the black community, and also the role that grandmothers have played. I think that it's pretty much, it's probably more than a stereotype, but probably in the black community, there's less involvement of the fathers than it is in a lot of other cultures. And therefore, the mother becomes a very significant figure, and the grandmother becomes very significant. Mm-hmm. And to me, that is so very special. And when you see these big, robust athletes, you know, these muscular guys that show so much tenderness and affection to that little 85 or 90 pound grandmother, you know, it's really heart moving. It's very warming. So I think it's very, very special. So grandparents can be there to give emotional support. A couple of interesting facts here concerning grand parents and grandchildren. Granddaughters and grandsons bond equally with their grandparents. In other words, there's very little difference in the degree that grandsons and granddaughters will bond to their grandparents. There is a tendency for both to be closer to the maternal than to the paternal grandparents. There's a tendency to be closer to the maternal grandparents. And I think that, in my opinion, a lot of that is because that usually the mother of the children has more power and more control in the situation, that as a general rule, there's more, in other words, there's more of an attachment between a grown adult woman who's a mother to her mother than it is for the son to his mother, especially in terms of the grandchildren, that the mother of a child seems to allow more access to the grandchildren. Now, whether that's the explanation or not, maybe I'm only speaking, you know, from my own experience. But children tend to also be closer to the grandmothers than to their grandfathers.
That nurturing that you spoke of earlier.
Exactly. Exactly. Now, Nancy had a grandfather who was probably considered to be more nurturing in a way than your grandmother. It was your mother's father and mother, right? He was a very nurturing, very loving and kind man, and of course the grandmother was more dominant, that was a little bit more outspoken, and probably took more of the leadership in the home, would you say? Or however, the grandfather was certainly the spiritual leader. He was a Baptist pastor. But I know that all of his grandchildren and his children speak very affectionately of him. Not that they did not have respect for the mother. But, you know, sometimes the roles are reversed. You know, men, because of societal expectations, have a tendency, you know, to stand off, to be more aloof, to not become involved with smaller children. They have less of a tendency to become bonded with the children. And again, the part of that is, let me just express a little bit more of my frustration and my anger. And it's the fact that when my children were born, I was treated like an alien. I was treated like a stranger and an alien by the hospital. I mean, honestly, that first of all, when I took my wife to the hospital, I could not even see her until after the baby was born. I was not allowed in the delivery room. You have to understand, that was back 40 years ago. And I was not even allowed in the hospital room when the baby was brought in to see its mother. I mean, it was like, you know, I was in the room visiting my wife, and the baby, my child, was brought into the room, and it was almost like they had met the plague, and they'd protect the child, and they run the other way. Now, supposedly the reason for that was, you know, that they were trying to protect the baby from bringing in some kind of outside disease or something, you know. But honestly, I'm going to tell you, all four of my children were born under those conditions, and I resent it, especially in the light of the fact now that the father is such an integral part of the birthing process. And what it denied me, it cheated me from the right to have a bonding experience with my child when they first came into the world. And I think that is a very great disservice. And that's all part of society. That was all part of the culture that day. And, you know, and that's, you know, men have stereotypically had to follow a certain role, and they had to behave themselves in a certain way. They couldn't show any sign of weakness, and they certainly couldn't show any emotions. They weren't supposed to cry. They're supposed to be this strong figure. Oh, that's a bunch of baloney. I mean, really, it's a lot of hogwash, isn't it? Okay. Unfortunately, because of the high mobility of families today in moving from one geographical location to another, that few grandparents have daily involvement with their grandchildren, and yet we do have the marvel of internet and email that you can send movies over the internet. So I guess that technology has taken grandparents away from their grandkids, but there's still very unique and creative ways that you can stay in touch. And with the decrease of long distance calling, you can call and talk to your grandkids on special occasions. One study has identified five basic types of grandparents. Five basic types of grandparents. And let me write these on the board. And we're going to see, Nancy, which one we're here. And number one, formal grandparents. Is that you? Number two, fun seekers. I know this is not us. I really used to have fun with my kids, but unfortunately, I don't have the energy to have fun with my grandkids. Parental surrogates. Number four, reservoirs. Maybe this is what I am. Reservoirs of family wisdom. The only question is, how do you get that wisdom out? How do you impart it? And number five, God forbid that this be it, distant figures. And fortunately, that's not. Distant figures. Five types of grandparents: formal grandparents, fun seekers, parental surrogates, reservoirs of family wisdom, and distant figures. Most parents, I think that, well, I say most, yeah, I think that would be an accurate statement, that most grandparents seek to make an effort to connect with their grandchildren, even if they're geographically away from them. And this, of course, can be through phone calls, cards, email, packages, visits, summer trips, vacations. Most parents, most grandparents can be looked upon as a source of strength and encouragement, regardless of the circumstance. Grandparents with a more traditional view tend to be formal figures who take on the role of defining moral behaviors and rules. I don't think that any grandparent has any more respect of their grandchildren than my wife's mother, that every child she has and every grandchild holds her in the highest esteem. She really, I guess, had pretty much limited involvement in their lives directly as far as the kids staying with her and, you know, and her babysitting or even spending the night with her. And one reason, of course, is that she was older when her younger kids were born. And so, you know, when her grandkids came along, she was pretty much up in years. But she was a very affectionate grandmother, one that was very loving and very kind. And again, it could also be a throwback to a grandparenting of another era, that my mother was pretty much of the opinion that she stayed, here's the way my mother operated. That you better not ever ask her to do anything. But she, if she volunteered to do it, she would do it. You were very hesitant to ask her to babysit. But oftentimes she would volunteer. And if she ever felt like that her kids were taking advantage of her, she would resent it. And she would say something like this, "I raised my kids, now you raise yours." But she did have a very significant input in her kids for a period of time at least. Especially one year when I had gone back to school and Nancy had gone to work, and she took on the role of caring for the kids during the day. But I would think that the older generation would probably take on more of the formal role of grandparents, of being there. And I'm thinking about like my own grandparents. I'm thinking about my grandfather. That to me, it was not like that he didn't care for his grandkids. I'm not real sure that he would go out of his way for them. He thought if he gave them a penny or a nickel or something like that, you know, that he'd done a great thing, or give them a piece of chewing gum. He used to have a custom of giving his grandkids a penny for every year old they were on the birthday. Well, that didn't add up to a whole lot, even if you were 40 years old, you understand. That'd just only be 40 cents. Of course, 40 cents back then might have been, a little bit more. But back in the 40s, you know, a nickel for your birthday, that might be about like a dollar now, you know. I can't imagine us getting away just getting our grandkids a dollar present. Let's see, our second type of grandparent, the fun seeker, would be usually when the grandparent would live a distance away and they would see the kids on a very infrequent basis. And so when they would come on special occasion, they would seek to make it a fun time. Parental surrogates would be when the grandparents take on the role as a parent. This happens many times when, for whatever reason, the parents are out of pocket. This could be sometimes in single parenting where the daughter is a parent who has custody of the kids and she has to go back to work to support the kids, and so grandmother becomes a surrogate mother. Sometimes it may be because of illness. It might be because of drugs and alcohol. A lot of different reasons why grandparents become surrogate parents. I've referred to our neighbor up in Jasper who inherited two grandkids after they got into their 60s. And you're talking about a family that was well-to-do financially and should have had the opportunity to have enjoyed their liberty and freedom. But they found themselves with two grandchildren that they're in the process of raising now because the parents were deemed to be unfit. All right, and then you have your reservoirs of family wisdom, and I guess these would be the grandparents who are in the background and who can make certainly an impact on the grandchildren especially, in telling their kids about, you know, some stories of old. And I can remember, let me back up here just for a moment. You know, I have some very warm memories of my aunt's father-in-law. This is my Aunt Florence. Nancy knew Aunt Florence, but she never knew Aunt Florence's father-in-law. But I have some very warm memories of that old gentleman. Now, what would that have been? That would have been my aunt's father-in-law. My goodness, wouldn't even be kin to me, would he? But I remember going visiting with my aunt, and they lived together. They you know, that was an extended family situation where, you know, three generations lived there together. And I remember going visiting my grandmother, and I remember this old gentleman, you know, just so kind of, he was kind and laid back, and he'd get us up in his lap, and we'd take our shoes off, and he'd count our toes, and this little piggy, you know, went to town, and, you know, this little piggy stayed at home, and I can still remember that. I couldn't have been over 3, 4, 5 years old, probably, maybe 4 years old, but that's what you think about grandparents, right? I don't remember that from my own grandparents. And then we have the distant figures And I guess these are the grandparents who are not involved for whatever reason. All right, let's take a look at multi-generational households. Multi-generational household. A multi-generational household would be one that would be defined as having three or more generations living together. Three or more generations living together, multi-generational. These are usually found in post-launching years. There are two different forms, two different situations where multi-generational households would be in function. One would be when married children and their offspring come back to live with the parents. Married children and their offspring, that would be three generations. Grandparents, children, and grandchildren. The other situation is during retirement stage when the elderly parents move in with their married children. So one would be when the married children move in with the parents with their kids, and the other would be when retired elderly parents move in with their married children. These arrangements can be stressful, disruptive, and on the other hand can be rewarding and be very rich in experience. The problem is intensified, of course, when you have a smaller house than you really need, when you have limited resources, when either the adult children or the elderly parents are in bad health, or where there might be emotional or mental problems. Some of the things that need to be dealt with, of course, in multi-generational settings is that rules and boundaries are going to have to be settled. Generally, the parents who own the home are the ones who feel like, rightfully so, that they should be able to pretty much call the shots. They would certainly want to take into consideration other people, and they would want it to be reasonable. But, you know, hey, if it's their home, and if you're moving in on them, they should have the right to determine what the guidelines are and what the rules are. Okay, other rules concern the division of household responsibilities. If you have a multi-generational setting, you would expect everybody to contribute, right? In fact, I'm of the opinion that any family should have a division of chores, that kids can begin to take on certain responsibilities in the household at a very young age, and you would assign them chores depending upon the level of maturity. You've also probably heard me refer to the experience that we had with a young man that we took into our home back in the 70s, a young man from Guatemala, a teenage boy who came to live with us for a year, and he went to school here in the States, a young man that we had come in contact with through my brother's missionary endeavors into Central America. He came from pretty substantial means. His daddy was relatively wealthy in Guatemala. In fact, this young man had come from a situation where they had three full-time maids in their home. But you know, all of that was in Guatemala. That was not here in the United States. And everybody had to carry their share of the load. We had a yard that required mowing of over an acre. We had to cut an acre yard, and we had another third of an acre of a garden. And so we had two older kids that were teenagers, and then we had this teenager, and they pretty much took the responsibility of keeping the yard cut and the garden worked, and then they did their share of washing the dishes and keeping the room straightened up. And he about went ballistic. He about ready to go back to Guatemala. But then he finally knuckled in, and he had made a visit to a lady, young lady friend that he'd met in school, and he had gone out to her abode, and he said he walked in and he said trash was piled up yay so high, and he proceeded to tell us, and which made us feel pretty good. He said, boy, that never would have happened in our home. He went through and described, it was very dramatic in how that he would have perceived how I would have reacted to that situation. But the bottom line is that every child in the household should take their rightful responsibility. The same thing is true when kids graduate from high school, and if they're not going to college, and if they're working at a full-time job, they should contribute to the household expenses. You would certainly be reasonable, but they need to learn responsibility. It would not be fair for you to pay all the bills and then take their full paycheck and then go out and party. You're not being fair to them. You're not teaching them the right kind of values. And then, of course, we've had some situations where that we have opened up our home to our adult children for a period of time, especially when they've lived out of state and they were coming back and were seeking to get their feet on the ground, and we would give them a space. And we would say, all right, we're going to allow you this amount of time to get your feet on the ground, and we're not going to really expect you to make any particular contribution to the household until this time. And it's only fair. It's not being unreasonable. It's teaching them responsibility. And the same thing would be true in any multi-generational setup. When an elderly family member moves into the home, it is essential to discuss certain issues, important issues. First, the couple should talk openly and honestly about their feelings, expectations, strengths, and limitations as they anticipate caring for an aging parent. Nancy and I made a decision several years before any of our parents came to the place that there was even a possibility of their having to move in with any of their adult children, and we had come to the conclusion that we would never allow our parents to go into a nursing home. Fortunately, we weren't faced with that option. We were with my aunt, and we had made her the same promise. But unfortunately, some circumstances came about whereby that she became incapacitated through a very severe stroke, and we were not in a position, we were not able to care for her. And it was one of the hardest decisions that we ever made when we had to put her in a nursing home. Of course, my mother died prematurely in a car accident at age 62, in good health. We were not faced with, in fact, my mother and dad both were killed in the same accident, and so that was very painful, but we were spared the reality of having to deal with some of the issues of the elderly. Nancy's mother lived to be 91 and a half, but she was so stubborn and independent that she refused to move in with anybody, and God smiled upon her that she was able to live on her own and never had to go into a nursing home. She certainly had a good support system around her. She had a family of children that loved her very much and who took care of her needs, even though they lived out of state. But there was always, on a pretty regular basis, one of the kids that would be there pretty frequently and stayed in contact constantly. And so, again, you know, we personally were spared that particular decision. But again, that we did assume the responsibility very gladly to take our aunt, my aunt, into our home. An aunt who never had any children, and she lost her husband when she was just a young woman, had been a widow all those years, a good woman, and she contributed. She wanted to feel like she was a part of the household. And when she came into our household, she more or less took responsibility of doing all the laundry. She did some of the cooking, as I recall. She would take her part of helping to clean the house. In other words, she was a very active, functioning part of the household. And she would not have had it any other way. Those are some of the issues, of course, you have to deal with. So one of the things that you have to discuss is, first of all, an open and honest conversation between the husband and the wife, and them to be in agreement as to what would be expected and required in caring for aging parents. A second set of questions has to do with the family as a whole. How do the other members of the family relate to this elderly person? That's important because you're bringing in a person who's going to put pressure on every member of the family. Again, my aunt's presence in our home, she was there, a couple of years maybe, really was a very positive. It was a very positive experience. And we've had our sons just recently. She'd been gone, 7 years? About 7 years now. And our grown kids now just recently mentioned how much they miss her, even now. All right, a third set of questions deals with adequate living space, privacy, and financial resources. And then finally, in seeking out to determine what kind of resources are in the community that can help to minister to the elderly. All right, the retirement stage. This is a scary topic. I've always felt like that I would never retire. I trust and pray that I do not ever completely retire. And I can't really say that I want to get to the place that I can do what I want to do because I'm doing what I want to do now. My contention all of my adult life, having been a minister all of my life, all of my adult life, has been why I retire. Because most people retire so they can do what they want to do. If you're already doing what you want to do, you don't need to retire. And yet, I understand that even say like a pastor, that there are a lot of pressures in being a pastor. And so I would think that even though you would never retire from the service of the Lord, that there are times that you would probably would like to get out from under so much responsibility. And you would certainly like to have the freedom. You would certainly like to have the financial freedom. Unfortunately, in Pentecostal circles that I grew up in, there was not a whole lot of consideration and concern for the retirement of ministers. Therefore, unfortunately, almost my total dependency is on Social Security and the Lord. I'm not sure I can depend a whole lot on Social Security. Therefore, my dependency must be upon the Lord. First of all, if Social Security does not go bankrupt, it'll bankrupt me because I doubt very seriously you can live on what Social Security pays. And then, of course, the second thing is that in just a matter of a few years, there are going to be so many people over the age of 65. In fact, there's a projection that maybe about by the year 2040, that 1 in 5 of every American will be 65 years or older. 1 out of every 5. Can you imagine the pressure that's going to put on the young people in having to provide taxation, you know, Social Security, because there's a lot of taxation, a lot of expense that goes into the support of the elderly. So retirement is certainly a time that most people look forward to because of the increase of freedom, but there's also some downsides. And one is that usually when the man is the main source of income, and his sense of purpose in life has been to provide the income, that had a tendency to give him a little bit more power in the relationship. But when he retires, that has a way of equaling out the power between the husband and the wife, and sometimes it doesn't set too well with the husband. Of course, one of the positives is that two people in retirement have more time for each other. They have time to enjoy one another and enjoy activities together. But then there's the downside to that. Because when you get old enough to retire, and if you do have enough money, there's always a possibility of failing health, you see. And so, you know, if you're not careful, you find yourself in a pessimistic view, and you can fail to enjoy the positive things and wonder about when the negative things are going to happen. So, you know, you have to get beyond that. All right, another is that when a wife has been, say, like a homekeeper, And the husband has been at work. She's pretty much had freedom to do as she pleased. And now here she has this man that's under her feet every way she turns. Some women don't like it. Now, according to Nancy, she seems to like that. And that's good. But sometimes a husband being at home can cramp the wife's style. Right? Here's another very important consideration. Do you understand that a lot of times a couple will evade having a head-on collision because a husband will just go off to work, get lost in his work, and more or less bury his head in the sand, and they don't deal with those issues, but when they're there with each other 24 hours a day, they have to either deal with the situation or they'll end up in a split. So what happens is you're put in a situation where you're almost forced to have to deal with the issues, whereas otherwise you would have run off from it and hid out at work. I'm persuaded to believe that a lot of husbands that are workaholics so they can just stay away from the tension that's at home. I would begin to wonder why that a husband of mine won't stay away from home so much. I would want to think that there would be a reason for him want to come home, wouldn't you? Another is that, little annoying things kind of start grinding on your nerves when you're exposed to it on a continuous basis. And then, of course, there's always the very real possibility of one becoming sick to the point that the other has to become the caretaker. And this could certainly put a strain, even under the best of conditions. The death of a beloved spouse often leaves the survivor severely depressed. Research shows that a large percentage of surviving spouses after a certain age, and I'm thinking after 65, that a large percentage of surviving spouses will die within a year of the spouse's decease. There was a situation, Brother Varner's church. He was supposed to be in here this past weekend in a seminar. He had a man in his church who was in leadership. I don't know how old he was. His kids were all teenagers. Couldn't have been real old. But he died of cancer. Of course, that was somewhat anticipated. But 2 weeks later, which was just this past week, his wife was found dead in her bed. I haven't heard any explanation from it at all. There was no indication of any particular illness, and you would think that perhaps that being younger like that, that it certainly wouldn't be tied in with any type of extreme grief, but that does happen in older years very often. All right, further, and bringing to a conclusion our discussion for tonight, we will look further into the caring. We've already talked basically about the situation where a couple retires and they're left intact in their home, but now let's look more specifically at caring for aging family members. The question of caring for aging parents is more of a question of how it's to be done rather than whether it is to be done. I certainly don't want to put any guilt or any added responsibility on any of my kids, but I think the biblical pattern is that every family takes care of their own. And according to the scripture, that the responsibility of aging parents is primarily that of sons and nephews. And then, of course, that could certainly mean daughters or nieces also. That's the biblical pattern. Again, when the cycle is completed and the elderly become dependent upon the adult children, we can say that we have genuinely moved from a unilateral commitment to a bilateral commitment. All right. How a family handles the stages of later life will depend on several key factors. I'll give you the three main factors here, and this will be all for tonight. Three main factors in determining how a family handles the stages of later life. The first is how well have they handled previous transitions. There are other transitions in life. And how well you've handled those other transitions may very well determine how that you'll handle the transition into old age. The second factor is what the family believes about the aging process. That if there is a fear that is perpetrated in the family about growing old, the fear of being neglected by one's children, of living in a state of declining happiness and health, it can very well become a self-fulfilling prophecy. That if you have that fear, like Job said, the thing that I have most feared has come upon me. And then thirdly, how people define themselves will determine how they're going to handle this transition into old age. Tying one's identity and life's purpose to advancing in a career, to earning money, to accumulating material goods, or even to parenting children, if that is the only thing that gives you sufficient reason for living, and then when those things no longer are a part of your life, then that may very well determine how well you're going to make the transition into old age. One of the things that is probably the most difficult for men, of course, in old age, is that first of all, they have built their identity on doing, on working, on action. And then, of course, when you get older and you're not able to do and to be involved in acting out or doing things, then they lose their real purpose for life. On the other hand, women generally find their purpose through nurturing and relationships, and women usually have a much easier time in making the transition. Well, that's all we have for tonight. I'm going to pass out test reviews for you, and let me just explain very quickly. In fact, I'll let Nancy pass these around, and I'll just give you a quick idea how you can utilize this. What I have chosen to do has been to list several concepts. In fact, there are about 65 items all total on the review sheet. I have several concepts here that you should be able at least to identify. You might be asked to identify them through multiple choice, or it could be through matching. I've given on some of these concepts, I've given you just a few more facts and a little bit more elaboration. If you know this, if you're able to pretty much to have an understanding of all of these concepts, I think you'll do very well on the test. So, outside of the possibility of asking you, look at items 59 and 60. There is a possibility that I might very well ask you a descriptive type of question here. I would say that if I did, I would probably choose between the two, 59 or 60, to write a short essay answer of describing the role of romantic love in the mate selection process in Western societies. That would be for you to talk very briefly about how it evolved. In other words, how did the process evolve and what was the purpose of romantic love in the mate processing mate selection process, and then be able to describe the Christian modeling for the family, including the role of covenant, grace, empowerment, and intimacy. Tie those in together. For example, covenant would certainly involve an unconditional commitment to that's based on unconditional love that creates an environment of grace, which provides family members the freedom to fail and to be forgiven, to experience forgiveness and to forgive, which in turn will give the opportunity for one another to empower other members. You should understand, of course, basically what empowerment is, and then how that can lead to open communication, that can lead to knowing and being known, which, of course, is intimacy, and how that the cycle can be repeated, that because of intimacy, that can circle back around and lead to a deeper commitment, which can lead to a freer expression of grace, that can further empower, that can lead to deeper intimacy. You can, I think you can pretty much put that in your own words. Okay, have any questions?
So you're going to pick which one we need?
Yeah. Yeah, you know both of them.
You're going to give us our study guides back on Thursday.
I'll try to get those back to you tomorrow night.
Okay?
That's all. Good night.